Today we're going to talk about some different techniques we can use to calculate integrals. Some integrals, like those of simple polynomial functions, are easy to calculate. In the last video in this series, we talked about how to reverse the power rule to calculate the integrals of these types of functions. But sometimes that isn't enough. If you're not able to calculate an integral given the function's original form, you may need to try some other techniques to simplify your function or break it down into smaller pieces that are easier to integrate. In general, you should try the following methods in the following order whenever you get stuck on an integral problem. First, U-substitution, then integration by parts, then integration with partial fractions. As you become more comfortable with solving integral problems, you'll get better at identifying which method to use, and you can skip straight to integration by parts or partial fractions. Keep in mind that there are other methods beyond these three for solving integrals. For now, we'll review only these three in more detail. But once you master these, you should check out integration of exponential, logarithmic, and trigonometric functions. U-substitution is a great method to try before the others because it's usually the easiest and the fastest method. It allows you to take a complicated piece of your integral and call it u, thereby simplifying the integral significantly. To perform a u-substitution, you need to identify u, then take the derivative of u, which you'll call du. Remember that you have to include a dx when you calculate du. It's usually easy to remember this because you have to solve your du equation for dx before you can substitute into your equation, putting in u and du. If u-substitution was the right method to choose, and if you've done your substitutions correctly, you should now have either gotten rid of all your x's or be able to cancel out any that remain, leaving you with only u's in your function. From here, you should be able to calculate the integral easily. You know that you've got a great candidate for a u-substitution problem if you can see two terms that are off by 1 degree. For example, you've got x and x squared and x cubed and x to the fourth, etc. Even natural log of x and x. The reason these are good candidates is because if you set u equal to the higher degree term, and then you calculate du, you'll see that by taking the derivative, du will include the lower degree term, which means that after substituting back into your integral, you might be able to cancel your lower degree terms. To use integration by parts, you're looking for a function you can easily break down into two pieces. These two pieces should be multiplied together in your original function. Ideally, you want the derivative of one of these pieces to be significantly simpler than the original piece. And by simpler, we usually mean of a lower degree. For example, the derivative of x is 1, which is much simpler than x. So, for example, if you're asked to integrate the function x times sine x, you should immediately think of integration by parts because you have two functions that are multiplied together, x and sine of x, and one of those parts, x, becomes much simpler when you take its derivative. In this method, you'll identify the two separate pieces of your function. You'll be integrating one of them and taking the derivative of the other. You should first identify the one you want to derive, and that piece should become simpler when you take its derivative. In this problem, the derivative of x is 1, which is simpler than x. The derivative of sine of x, on the other hand, is cosine of x, which isn't really simpler than sine of x. Therefore, you'll want to derive x, which means you'll be integrating sine of x. You'll say that the piece you're deriving, x, is equal to u, and you'll calculate its derivative, du, and get 1. You'll call the piece you're integrating dv, remembering always to include a dx with this part, and then take its integral, v, to get negative cosine of x. When you integrate, the dx falls away. Now that you have each of these four pieces, all you need to do is plug them into the integration by parts formula, which tells you that the integral of u times dv is equal to u times v minus the integral of v times du. Once you plug in for u, v, v again, and du, the remaining integral should be much simpler to calculate than the original integral. If u-substitution and integration by parts aren't working for you, you may want to try partial fractions. This method can be useful whenever you have a rational function, or fraction, to integrate. In fact, if your original function is a fraction, you may want to try partial fractions before U-substitution or integration by parts. This method will allow you to break your fraction into smaller, more manageable fractions that are easier to integrate. Before you can actually perform the partial fraction decomposition, you need to make sure that the degree of the numerator is not greater than the degree of the denominator. If it is, you need to perform polynomial long division on the fraction to reduce it. Once you have, you want to factor the denominator as much as possible. After it's completely factored, split each factor of the denominator into its own fraction, where the numerator is a sequence of new variables, a, b, c, as many as you need to cover the number of factors that you have. The sum of these fractions should be set equal to the original function. Keep in mind that the numerator of a linear, or first degree factor, will be the single variable, a, b, c, etc. If the denominator is a quadratic factor, where the degree is 2 or more, the numerator will be ax plus b, cx plus d, etc. If you have a repeated factor, in other words, two or more of the same factor, then you need to include a fraction for every degree of that factor lower than the factor itself. In other words, if the original denominator factors into the quantity x plus 1 cubed, then you have a factor of x plus 1 that's repeated 3 times. Your partial fraction decomposition should then include one fraction for x plus 1, another for x plus 1 squared, and another for x plus 1 cubed. Once you've set up your decomposition, you'll need to multiply both sides of your equation by the denominator from the left-hand side. Then, cancel terms to simplify as much as possible. From here, all that's left to do is expand your terms and use simultaneous equations to solve for each of your variables, a, b, c, etc. After you found their values, plug them back into your original decomposition. You should now have a new set of fractions that you can integrate to get your final answer. Next time, we'll use what we've learned today to review some common applications of integration. I'll see you then. Click on a video for a more in-depth look at the topics covered. Review this video by clicking the links on the right, and subscribe to be notified of future videos.